sort of a panoramic view, very personal view of inference. I have to say that I feel very privileged and lucky to be here today, given this talk. I've been working on this since 1980, 30 years, coincided with 30 years of my accent. And I think I've reached a level, a maturity level, that I can't believe I'm that old to begin with. But I think I have some, somehow I've been so lucky that things have landed on my lap in a way that I totally unexpected. Now, since I'm sure I'm going to run out of time, I'm going to start from the end and tell you exactly what I want to say. And this is a hypothetical email to Bradley Ephron, who is a mentor professor at Stanford. And I love the way he phrases it. So, dear Brad, our profession's 260-year search for a dependable, objective-based theory is now over. Max N. wins. In fact, not only objective-based theory, but something beyond base is what turns out to be, and not just Max End, something that is, I don't think James was completely aware of this. But I'm going to try to show you why. Now first, let me spin Ed here. Now this is it looks just like my cat. You see that this cat is a little confused after participating in a famous physics experiment, and you can see, I want to ask you, how many of you see Ed spinning that way? Please raise your hand. How many of you see Ed spinning that way? Raise your hand. Now, this is not a joke. By your mental power of just thinking of you want this to spin right or left, this guy spins right or left. In fact, it takes just a little training to just make it spin any way you want. Look, if you look outside a little bit and you see, because you're going to see Ed going this way and that way. If you pick it up going this way, it will continue spinning that way. If you pick it up spinning that way, it will continue spinning that way. You see it? Can you do that? Can you make it spin one way or the other?
Yes.
Well, it takes a little training, but I mean, you see that some people here are getting it. They see it spinning the other way. Well, this is because you're choosing your data space up to you. That's why this is a concrete example of data theory. I'll just give you a little bit, a moment more so you can see. By the way, this is a famous cat on the internet, so you can just Google later and you can do that. The spinning cat emotion or something like that. Okay. This is the thing. We think through metaphors. This is a human's actually thing. This is another wonderful statement from George Lakoff, a linguist at Berkeley. Goodness is upright and luminous. You understand what that means. And then you realize that we're mixing up here ethics with physics. You're mixing up geometry with physics, with gravity has an orientation. Goodness has an orientation. Up is better than down. I mean, you may say, well, there's a tribe in northeast Alaska where it's the opposite. I mean, because they think goodness is in the center of the earth without light is much better. Sure, but my point is, and not my point, it's the point of all these linguists that I agree completely, is that it organizes your thinking. I mean, for that trying, the world will be organized according to those metaphors. Now, this is not without consequences. For example, this is how the world would look if an Inca from Machu Picchu had discovered Europe. In fact, that would be the map we would all be looking at. It looks wrong because, I mean, why do we have the maps the other way around? Because a European who said, well, we discovered America, And therefore, I'm better than you. Therefore, I'm on top of you. Therefore, I picture myself at the top. Now, when I say this to many fellow Americans, they get confused. They say, no, but you, it's down there in South America. I mean, how come there is no down there in South America? For people in South America, it's down there in the United States. I mean, down is where things fall. So, we're not falling off the earth in South America. So, my point is that metaphors rule the way you look at the world. I mean, and this is true for mathematics as well. Every time we do mathematical statements, we coach that in metaphors. We give names to the equations and the objects of mathematics. Otherwise, they don't make any sense. This is my starting point. There are no naked facts. I want to bring the brain into this because the brain is central. Everything you see around is just a product of biological brains, as much as we know now. Maybe in the future we will have machines that will do this as well, but so far that's the only... My cat actually does have a knowledge of the universe that is, in a sense, pretty similar to mine at some point. Right? But it's like... It doesn't, of course, doesn't have the same picture of the universe as I do. But I want to say this might may be my starting point. I have a brain. I say ops, not observation, because observation is too long a word, doesn't fit on the margin here. So just ops, complicated thing. I want to understand X. I need to predict future X. I need to do that because otherwise I die. I mean, we have the result of solving this problem. People are amazed when you study a problem enough to see geometry everywhere. You say, well, why do we see geometry everywhere? I say, it's not geometry, it's inference. It's because inference is what brains do. Brains evolve just to make sense of inference, of movement, in fact. There's some biological evidence that brains develop just to make sense out of the uncertainty that comes from changing position. Anyway, so, it's all about data theory, and that's what I'm going to try to prove you now. There are no immaculate observations, no theoretical vacuum, no fact without fiction, and no data without theory. And what you see is an object. Data is data theory always if it has meaning. Why is that? Why? And the answer is categorically trivial. And the importance of this is because it's for all data, not just for some data. For all data, it's the meaning of what we mean by data is always a two-sided object. Why is that? Because in order for a data to be able to participate as an argument of a probability statement, it must be a logical proposition in a given domain of discourse. Therefore, in order for data to be data, it must have meaning. Now, for the record, I hope the camera is it's rolling, because I've said that so many times, I'll say it just one more time. A pure number is not data. The number 2.7, it's a pure number, is not data. It's only data if you think of it as 2.7 is the result of such and such an experiment. Then it becomes data. It becomes a logical proposition. It could be true that it's the result of that, or false that it's the result of that. That's it. That triviality changes science at the genesis. Now, what do I mean by meaning? And I'm going to make another outrageous thing. I have found the meaning of meaning. It's not a joke. What I mean by meaning is a probability distribution. That's it. In fact, all the meaning there is in the probability distribution that is always attached to the data, because otherwise it's not data. And then you have this mapping between what is theory? It's an explanation for the data. And what is it? What qualifies it as a theory? A probability distribution for the data. In other words, when you say, okay, theory is a collection of statements about the world that allow you to assign probability distributions to the result of experiments. When you say, well, conditional on quantum, or let's say classical mechanics to be true, then if I do this experiment, I put something here at a given distance from the, and I let it go, then it will give me the probability that it will take some amount of time. Well, always probability, because you have to measure them. The measurement apparatus has some error as well. So even if it is deterministic, it's at the end probabilistic anyway. So that's what a theory is. A theory is just an explanation for the data. It's also, in the last 20 years or so, it has become much more clear the connection with coding theory. In fact, if you check any book, modern book on information theory, like Cover's book, for example, or the minimum description length gang, you will see that there is a one-to-one correspondence between probability distributions and codes. Every code corresponds to a probability distribution. Every probability distribution corresponds to a code for compressing the data. Therefore, for example, if you have a sequence of zeros and ones that is just 01, 01, 01, 01, 01, you can have a very good code for that, very short, right? And you just say print 0, print 1, loop. That's it. A very short program describes that. That is a very simple theory. When you have something much more complicated, the shorter description, the shorter code will have to catch all the invariances in the data. I mean, that would be the theory. Now you may say, but Carlos, before I anticipate maybe questions, say, wait a second. Look, I have a CD-ROM right here. It's just a one-dimensional list of zeros and ones. You have movies here. You have internet games. Whatever, everything can be coded in a long string, one-dimensional string of zeros and ones. Say, well, that's data for you. I say, wrong. This long string of zeros and ones is not data. In order for you to see a movie with that CD-ROM, you have to put it in a CD-ROM player, and you have to have somebody who watches the movie who understands that that's a movie. All that is a highly multidimensional object, not one-dimensional at all. Because data and theory are always together, always, logically always, it's always the proverbial two-sided thing. Object, data always comes with a hidden side. And you may say, oh, this looks like hidden variables in quantum mechanics. Sure it does, but it's not just quantum mechanics, it's all data. It's general relativity, it's philosophy, it's whatever. In order for data to be data, it has to come with this sided, hidden thing that explains it, or the possibility of explaining it. Otherwise, it's not data, it's a pure number. A long list of zeros and ones, no matter how long, is just like 2.7. You put a dot at the beginning, it would be a number with many decimals. But it's, in order to be data, it's not one dimensional, because it has the probability of the other side, okay, very highly dimensional. Now, usually the statistical manifold is just a collection of probability distribution. I say that's another mistake. We have to, because data and theory are always together, the data space is always a subset of a data manifold. That doesn't really have to have a manifold structure. This can be any set, as long as it is a topological Hausdorff space would be fine. And this is the collection of all finite probability, not even probability, just finite measures on that space X. So, for example, if X has infinite many elements, then this object here is infinite dimensional. It has been realized also lately that the fact that you operate with normalized probability distributions is not relevant, because, I mean, it's not very important. As long as you have a finite measure, as long as it is the measure of the whole data space is finite, you can always renormalize, and you lose nothing. Now, in standard statistics, statistics as we know it, the only manifolds, or the manifolds that have been studied the most, are really topologically trivial, in the sense that they have homogeneous. You have a set of a fixed data space cross a model, so the model gives positive probabilities to the same data.